All of us can, if we desire, tap an unsuspected source of pure energy and creative power. And this source, fully adequate and freely available, is our silent partner, the subconscious mind. By correctly using this potential, we can gain release from tension and frustration and have at our disposal abundant energy and new mental power and physical well-being. These things we gain without striving. There's no laborious routine to follow. We simply recognize our subconscious mind and permit it to function under proper conditions. If you'll observe the working habits of leaders in any field, you'll find that important discoveries are seldom made while engaged actively in research investigation. New insights, bold ideas, and plans are contributed by the underlying activity of the mind, the subconscious function, and usually comes during a time of leisure. Just about all great scientists, artists, writers, musicians, top-flight businessmen will tell you that their best ideas come not while they're actively engaged in seeking them, but as the French mathematician Henri Poincaré said, creative ideas did not come to him while he was working at his desk, but frequently flashed into his mind while he was engaged in other activities. Now, you'll find this true of every really great man or woman who ever lived. The most momentous concept of this age, the relationship of time and space and the nature of reality, sprang into the mind of Albert Einstein while he was confined to his bed because of illness. Who can say, but for this period of enforced quiet and relaxation, this world may not have been in the atomic age, good or bad, depending on your attitude. The subconscious area of the mind is an unplumbed reservoir of creative insight and intuition. As high as 75% of scientists and inventors surveyed admitted that their best ideas did not come to them while they were actively engaged in work and research, but at odd moments when they were relaxing. Their discoveries were contributed then by the inner underlying activity of mind, the subconscious function. Now, you or anyone else can put this tremendous problem-solving part of your mind to work, with results you'll find to be little short of amazing. You've probably noticed, just as do the great inventors, scientists, thinkers, artists, writers, and so on, that your best ideas come to you not when you're worrying about them or working at your desk or on the problem you're trying to solve, but rather your best ideas, the solution to your problems, seem to just pop into your mind at odd times when you're relaxing, when you're not thinking of the problem. Of course, it wouldn't if you hadn't been thinking of it. Have you ever tried to think of someone's name and the harder you thought about it, the more difficult it was to remember? But as soon as you quit thinking consciously about it, it popped into your mind. Well, this is your subconscious at work. It contains all information which has ever come your way. It stores every word, act, sight, smell, thought, every conversation you've overheard, every sound, every book, paper, or magazine you've ever read. Add this fantastic storehouse of information to its natural intuition, and you have a tool that can solve just about any problem you want to give it. It's not necessary for an individual to have technical training in the field of psychology to understand and appreciate the unlimited creative power of the human mind. Of course, the more knowledge, the better, but let me give you an example of how you can put your subconscious to work. First, pick a problem you want very much to solve. It can be anything from increasing your income, solving a business problem, writing a story, solving a personal problem of some kind, any kind of problem. Realize right at the outset that there are two kinds of problems, those over which we can exercise no control and those we as individuals can solve. If you fall out of a tree, the problem is then out of your hands. But about 95% or more of our problems are within our own individual power to solve. Now, the first thing you do is state the problem. Write it out in complete and simple detail. Realize that it can be solved and begin to turn it over in your mind. Think of as many possible solutions as possible, realizing while you do that you're merely feeding, starting your subconscious to work, and that the likelihood of your solving it with your conscious mind is pretty slim, like remembering a name you've forgotten. Read and study as many things which pertain to your problem as you can find, and then forget it. Think of something else. Try not to think consciously of the problem at all. If nothing happens for 24 hours or so, do it all over again. Attack the problem with your conscious mind, work on it as hard as you can, and then forget it again. One fine day soon, you'll be relaxing, thinking of nothing at all, and the solution will come, perfectly clear and logical. Trying to solve problems with a conscious mind is unnecessarily limiting yourself to probably less than 1% of your mental ability. You can use it all by stating the problem consciously and then letting your subconscious do the work for you. every experience or condition of our life, success or failure, progress or frustration, growth or stagnation, is the result of an action or process selected and set in motion by our conscious mind. But to develop our full powers, it is necessary that we learn to use the creative power of both functions of our mind, the subconscious as well as the conscious, continuously and intelligently. Every condition, every experience of life is the result of our mental and emotional activity. We can do only what we think we can do. We can have only what we think we can have. Everything we do and are and have is the result of thought. We never express anything that we do not first have in our mind. Hence, the secret of attainment, of progress, of developing a creative personality is found in constructive mental and emotional activity. The external world is but a reflection of the world within us. Whatever is imaged in our inner life will be reflected in our personal world. Our mental and emotional activity, focused on a desire, a picture in our mind, will supply us with limitless energy and will take whatever form our mind demands. Thoughts of personal growth and progress, of earning a good income, of having influence with people, of experiencing satisfaction in our work and our daily life, the things we call success and happiness, reflect themselves in time in the conditions under which we work and live. Thoughts of doubt, frustration, failure, and personal limitations operate in precisely the same fashion. When the average individual is told that mind has unlimited power available for its use, the statement is usually passed off as high-pressure inspiration. But the facts of everyday experience prove that the human mind actually has amazing powers, which few of us ever draw upon, so slight is our knowledge and so limited is our faith. The easiest thing in the world is to drift without purpose or direction, so far as our thoughts and feelings are concerned. When we do this, we're letting the creative power of mind go to waste. Modern science is based on controlled experimentation and observation. And the only way any person can know whether or not mind does have unlimited power available for its use is for that person to test the idea by actual personal experience. Realize that your great subconscious mind must act on orders given it from your conscious mind. Give it a job to do, and then watch the results. Then give it a bigger job, and then another. Top business executives, leaders in the field of science realize how this works and use this technique to solve their problems and reach their goals. You can do the same. It has been written that there lurks deep within each of us a wellspring of talent, even genius. If it is to be found, it will come through the systematic exploration of our subconscious minds. What gives to a lone, frail woman the strength to lift an automobile and release her husband whose life is in danger, as has happened? From what source is the soldier in battle inspired and empowered to perform amazing acts of heroism and daring? What gave men and women the strength during the San Francisco earthquake and fire to perform deeds utterly impossible under normal conditions? Well, according to Mr. Williams, it's through the subconscious mind that seemingly unlimited power and strength are available in such times of emergency and danger. Now consider this case. The late Dr. Brown Landone was one of the really great men of this generation. He was a distinguished lecturer and author, his most significant work being a 7-volume history of civilization. Although 98 years old at the time of his death, his personality and general physical appearance were those of a person not over 50, so well preserved was he in health and physical form. He is said to have been one of the really great youthful men of his generation. Yet during his youth, he was an invalid for 17 years. His time was spent in a bed or in a wheelchair. His knees were swollen to twice the normal size, and his heart was organically impaired. One day, the Landone plantation home caught fire, and this young man, who could not under any circumstances climb a flight of stairs or walk under normal conditions, not only ran up the stairs of his home, but carried down one after another 3 heavy trunks containing valuables. Literally hundreds of similar experiences are known to science. In the presence of danger, superhuman strength is available. What's the source of this vast reserve of power, such limitless and immediate wisdom? Insofar as present-day knowledge is concerned, its source is in the largely unexplored field of subconscious motivation. Think how we can change our lives by consciously using more of this strength we have within us. Have you ever thought much about the part you play, your role in this great play called life? Well, it's important. I mean, it may be far more important than you realize. Nature has endowed many of her creatures with what's known as protective coloring. That is, the coloring of a creature of the woods is such that it blends with the background, making it difficult to see. You can look right at a motionless deer, elk, or bird, just about any animal, and not even see it. So perfectly does it blend with its environment. The chameleon can even change his color patterns to blend with different backgrounds. But as usual, nature gave to the human being an even greater gift. He can make his surroundings match him. By that I mean, a person's environment will gradually change to fit the kind of person he becomes. And it's here that how we act out our role on the stage of life becomes a matter of the greatest importance. It seems that before a person can accomplish something, he must first become the kind of individual to whom this something would belong. By acting the part of the person he wants to be, he can gradually actually become that person. And as he does, his circumstances and environment will change to fit the new personality. And he's the only creature on earth who can bring about this wonderful and amazing condition. Now, everyone knows that feelings trigger actions. That is, if you feel angry, you'll usually get angry. If you feel sad, you'll act sad. If you feel happy, you'll act happy. All right. But what far too few people realize is that it will also work the other way around. For example, let's say that you know the kind of person you'd like to be, that you're not completely happy and satisfied with the person you now are. If you have a clear mental image of the person you'd like to be, you can actually become that person in time by acting as though you were that person for a sufficient length of time. You'll not only become that person in reality, but you'll also attract to yourself the kind of life and the things that person would have.